My name's John Glendon. I'm a Rotary Youth Exchange student from Canada. From Canada, I went to Auckland, New Zealand. And I'm in Fiji right now working on a project bringing tablets to kids. My role in this project is to be the group photographer, the guy who lifts the equipment, and I've taken somewhat of a teacher role. I just feel a good connection with the kids because they're so similar to my age, and I like having something that I know and pretty confident in, and then letting them know. The idea of going across the world to live with a family who you've never met, to go to a school where you don't know a single person, to go to a country where you possibly don't know the language, is absolutely terrifying. I was so afraid, so scared of absolutely everything. I was scared about like the little things, like, what if they don't have my favorite brand of toothpaste? But if I could give one word of advice, one sentence of advice to anybody and every kid in the world, is just do it. You won't regret it. In 6 months, I've become a different person. Emotionally, physically, mentally, I see things differently and I act differently and I'm confident in the way of speaking to people. I can't wait just to keep doing what I'm doing. I'm so happy with where I am in my life. I'm so happy that I've been able to teach and to tell people about my experiences, to hear their stories. Rotary Youth Exchange is where my new life and my new beginnings have started, and I can't thank Rotary enough.
Good afternoon, Rotarians, friends, and guests. I'm Hannibal B. Johnson. It's my privilege as president to welcome you to the Rotary Club of Tulsa. We won't meet again until January the 9th. As we convene for this final meeting of 2018, let me send you off on your holiday journey with an old Irish blessing. May you always have work for your hands to do. May your pockets hold always a coin or two. May the sun shine bright on your window pane. May the rainbow be certain to follow each rain. May the hand of a friend always be near you, and may God fill your heart with gladness to cheer you. If you haven't already done so, please take a moment now to silence your phones. Thank you. A special thanks to Tom Wolfe for our pre-meeting musical interlude. Let's begin our program with an invocation and song from Jessica Moffitt, followed by visitor introductions from Carl Vincent.
Today's a special day because it is our last meeting, and it is our custom to sing Silent Night at this meeting. And also, we will light a candle today. So if you would take a moment now to find the matches and the candle. Go ahead and light it now, and we're going to take our house lights down. And you can take some of these down also, Miguel, down front. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly. Let's sing verse 2. Silent night, holy night, shepherds, shepherds quake at the sight. Glory stream from heaven afar, heavenly hosts. Heavenly hosts sing Alleluia. Gracious and almighty God, we pause before you this day to welcome peace. We welcome peace into our own hearts. We welcome peace into our world. We pray especially today for places and for people who do not have peace. And we acknowledge this day that you are our hope. Make us agents of your love and your grace. We pray especially, Lord, that you will use this club in 2019 to continue to change the world for good. We pray that you will continue to inspire us for greatness and for goodness and for service. We pray today, Lord God, that you would help us to have a sacred season, that you would help us to see beyond the gifts and the food and the trees, to the highest cause and to the great cause of love for one another and for this world. In this we pray. Amen.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the Intergalactic Rotary Club of Tulsa, where the members are stellar and the principles we espouse are universal. We're glad you're here today. I'm going to introduce our guests and their host Rotarians. If you'll please stand up when I call your names, and then you may be seated again. And then we'll recognize visiting Rotarians. Please hold your applause till we've introduced everyone. Today, President-elect David Wagner has his son, Ethan Wagner, accompanying him. He's with the Bank of Oklahoma Mortgage. Past President Scott Filstrup has Rick Stearns with him. Thank you, Mr. Stearns, for coming. Matthew Bristow, former Sergeant-at-Arms, has with him Jim Hawkins, who I believe may be related to him as a father-in-law, River City Development. Trish Kirkstra has Mandy Barrett with her today. Michael Turner has two guests, Brent Montgomery and Ann Ghostbear, both of Southern Nazarene University, where I believe they're starting a new veterans program that Michael's involved in. Tanya Blansett brought with her guest Timothy Reether, who's with United States Aviation Company. Thank you for coming. John Croissant has Deborah Croissant with him of Muse Intimates. Rob Walters brought Pat Turney of J-Mark Business Solutions. Paula Wood brought her friend Aaron Davis, leadingeducators.org. Jerry Barrientos brought a distinguished guest with her today, Henry Barrientos, her awesome son. Tulsa Chamber of Commerce President Mike Neal has Justin McLaughlin with him. Justin, thanks for coming today. And Chuck Wilson, our esteemed membership chair, has Scott Fitzgerald with him from Channel 2. And we have a few visiting Rotarians today. Brian O'Hara with the Jenks Club. Hi, Brian. Adam Jones also with the Jenks Club. Hi, Adam. And Ben Gorell with Southside. How are you, Ben? Please join me in welcoming our guests.
Thank you, Jessica and Carl. Special thanks to this week's meeting sponsors, Bank First, Paul Bowman, Bonnie Curry, Gordon Greer, Bill Miller, J.D. Young, Doug Stewart. Our announcements, committee meetings. Foundation grants will meet in room 233. The Tulsa Fire Department will have a special housing ceremony to welcome a new Tulsa Fire apparatus. The most exciting part about the event is that Ladder 22 is being dedicated to a man that spent much of his life protecting Tulsa and her citizens. Tulsa Fire Chief E. Stanley Hawkins served the citizens of Tulsa for 37 years. Ladder 22 will be known as the Hawk, and it will be adorned with special graphics to celebrate the contributions that Chief Hawkins made during his career. The housing ceremony will be held tomorrow from 1:30 to 3 o'clock at Station 22. Stanley Hawkins served as president of the Rotary Club of Tulsa during 1984-1985. He was a Rotarian for 49 years. Great news. The Terracon Foundation Board has awarded the Rotary Club of Tulsa Foundation a grant of $3,000 in support of Camp Enterprise. Special thanks to past president Mike Homan and Karen McCannell for all their efforts in making this donation possible. January 23rd is our annual business visitation day. Instead of attending the regular Wednesday Rotary Club meeting, members have the opportunity to visit some of the firms and organizations represented by our club membership. If you'd like to host a group of Rotarians for lunch at your business, please fill out the sign-up form that's on your table or contact Lane Dolly. The Rotary Youth Exchange Committee is looking for host families for the annual South Central Rotary Youth Exchange Conference. Over 200 exchange students will be in Tulsa the weekend of January 25th. And if you're interested in hosting two or more students in your home on that Friday night, please contact Trisha Kirkstra. Additional information and sign-up forms are on your table. The Rotary Club of Tulsa created the Henry P. Iba Citizen Athlete Awards in 1993. It's an annual fundraising gala benefiting the Rotary Club of Tulsa Foundation. The Iba Awards honored the memory and legacy of Henry P. Iba, a stellar coach, a leader, and a citizen. Since inception, the Iba Awards have recognized influential male and female sports figures for their athletic prowess and, more importantly, their demonstrated commitment to community. Without exception, Iba Awards recipients have done more than just donate to worthy causes. They personally engaged with their chosen charitable causes. This year marked the 25th anniversary of the Iba Awards. What a milestone it was. This special year also afforded the Rotary Club of Tulsa a chance to reflect on not just the past, but also on the future. And after intense discussion and debate, we have decided to sunset the Iba Awards. We're thankful for the men and women who made the Iba Awards possible year in and year out. The Iba family, Coach Sutton, local sportscaster, fellow Rotarians, donors, citizen athletes, patrons, supporters, and others. The Rotary Club of Tulsa is now working on a new fundraiser that will benefit the Rotary Club of Tulsa Foundation. Our luncheon program on Wednesday, January the 9th, 2019, will include a tribute to the Iba Awards and a big reveal about what's on the horizon in terms of a replacement fundraiser. We look forward to your support and your engagement as we enter this new phase. Our Rotary Inspiration. Our Rotary Inspiration this week is Jerry Barrientos. An anonymous Rotarian writes the following. Jerry Barrientos is a quiet Rotarian who makes a significant impact on our club, mostly behind the scenes. Jerry was a beneficiary of Rotary youth programs and scholarships growing up, and she sought out Rotary in 2007 to start giving back, serving in multiple leadership roles in our club the past decade. Jerry's an active reminder of why it's so important to support youth programming. Jerry is currently serving as secretary treasurer in our club and takes on challenges and opportunities with equal resolve. Jerry has traveled to Nicaragua to support our water wells. She supported our youth programs, is consistent and a generous donor to Rotary initiatives, both local and international. Jerry is an example to us, to all of us, of engagement in our Rotary community. Thank you, Jerry. So, Jerry, on behalf of the Rotary Club of Tulsa, please accept your Rotary International themed Be the Inspiration lapel pin for being our Rotary Inspiration. Thank you so much. At this time, I'd like to invite past president Matt Davis to the stage for a special Paul Harris Fellow presentation. For a Christmas gift this year, Matt is honoring his children by making them Paul Harris Fellows. Matthew and Megan Davis are being recognized with a special honor in appreciation for the ways in which their lives exemplify the humanitarian and educational objectives of the Rotary International Foundation. Unfortunately, they're both unable to be with us here today, But Matt will present their Paul Harris Fellow certificates and lapel pins on Christmas morning. It's a gift that makes a difference in the lives of less fortunate people all around the globe. Thank you, Matt. The Rotary Foundation is one of the largest and most important programs of Rotary. Without Rotary International Foundation, our Rotary clubs couldn't continue the many humanitarian programs and efforts to promote world understanding and peace that define us. By giving from all your heart, each and every year, you'll support families and change lives. Information about Paul Harris Society is on your tables. At this time, please welcome Jerry Barrientos and DJ Mauro Ingram with new member introductions.
As a native Tulsan, Eric Holland is deeply invested in his four children and the guardian of three men with developmental disabilities. He serves many professional and service roles in our community. In 2005, Eric founded Collin & Associates, LLC, an investigations consulting and security company. His agency focuses on investigation and litigation support in many areas of the law. Jury trial consulting in both civil and criminal litigation to include pretrial investigation, focus groups, and mock juries. His agency specializes in corruption, custody cases, fraud, wrongful and suspicious deaths, criminal defense, crisis management, stalking intervention, human trafficking, missing or endangered children, and insurance, corporate security, and defense. His professional background includes more than 1,000 cases in many areas of the law. He has extensive experience as an investigator and consultant to attorneys in jury trials in federal and state court, plus a military court martial. Eric has been part of the legal teams that have delivered well over 50 victories in court and have been a key part of over 20 jury trial victories. In March of this year, he founded a nonprofit called Another Chance Justice Project that focuses on Oklahoma's female mass incarceration issue by assisting women that have excessive or wrongful convictions. Since June, his team has assisted 30 women with parole and 5 women with reduced sentences. I had to ask him to minimize some of these big words so I can understand what they mean. Eric has assisted 5 people that were wrongfully convicted gain their freedom, and number 6 should come in early spring 2019. Eric and his cases have been well publicized locally, nationally, and in the UK. His belief is quoted by the Tulsa Ruled as, freedom is the most important aspect people enjoy in their lives. The loss of freedom is second only to death. Eric has helped families find 5 missing and endangered children safely. He has been a volunteer at TARC for 17 years, a founding member of the Oklahoma Honor Flights, a member of Center of Nonprofits, and most recently named as a TEDx speaker on March 1st at TU, discussing Oklahoma's female mass incarceration epidemic. Welcome to the Rotary Club of Tulsa.
Good afternoon. It's an honor and a privilege for me to introduce my ultimate boss here in the Tulsa area. Major Mark Harwell and his wife, Major Jan, assumed their appointments as area commanders for the Salvation Army Tulsa Metropolitan Command in mid-June of this year. Major Mark Harwell is a native Texan and entered the Salvation Army's Evangeline Booth College for Officers in Atlanta, Georgia in 1989. While there, he met and courted his wife, Jan, and they've been married for 27 years. The Harwells have served as corps officers, which is pastors in the Salvation Army, in the Georgia communities of LaGrange, Thomasville, Brunswick, and Columbus. They also served as corps officers in Daytona Beach, Florida. For the past decade, the Harwells have served in divisional leadership roles as staff officers at divisional headquarters in Florida, Kentucky, and Texas. Prior to their new assignment to Tulsa, Major Mark served as the General Secretary and Second-in-Command for the Texas Division, and Major Jan served as the Divisional Secretary for Personnel. The Harwells have one daughter, Kelsey, who is pursuing a graduate degree in school psychology at Texas Women's University in Denton, Texas. Both Major Mark and Jan are children of the regiment, in that both sets of their parents served as Salvation Army officers and are now enjoying honored retirement. So, of interest to us, both Major Mark and Jan are talented musicians. We're always happy to know that here in Rotary, enjoying both vocal and brass music. Major Mark also plays the piano. He enjoys fishing and golf, and Major Janet enjoys a good book. They both enjoy live theater. Now, a couple weeks ago, we announced that on the Rotary Day of Ringing, we raised $4,378.98, and I heard a number of people say, oh, we didn't make our $5,000 goal. So I will bet that if any of you want to make up that $621.02, that Major Mark Harwell would be delighted to take that money or check from you today so we hit our $5,000 goal. It is an honor and privilege to, he has been a Rotarian before, to present you with the four-way test and your pen. Thank you.
Thank you, Jerry and DJ, and welcome Eric and Mark. At this time, help me welcome our Sarge, Daniel Gomez. Daniel.
Frosty the Snowman was a jolly, happy soul, with a corncob pipe and a button nose, and his eyes made out of coal. Frosty the Snowman made the children laugh and play. Were they surprised when before their eyes he came to life that day? There must have been some magic in that old silk hat they found, for when they placed it on his head, he began to dance around. Oh, Frosty the Snowman was alive as he could be, and the children say he could laugh and play just the same as you and me.
Well, thank you, Frosty, for joining us today. And thank you, President Hannibal, for not making me wear that suit. So, of course, Christmas is coming up, so I put together a couple of cartoons here. This is, of course, Santa and Rudolph at the bar asking for another round, and Rudolph's having a little too much fun there. I've been told that's why his nose is always red. He's a little bit of a lush. This is for after Christmas, the Christmas tree. So you were dumped right after Christmas. Ouch. And of course, this one's my favorite. Santa talking to Rudolph. Sorry, Rudolph, you're being replaced with my new GPS sleigh guiding app. So, thought those would be a little funny for Christmas. So here to start off, here's the from last week. You remember the Salvation Army bell ringers? Well, this is from Tom Wolfe and Karen Keith. Had a couple of visitors. These are, by the way, are just strange kids that showed up and wanted to ring the bell. And with Christmas spirit, of course, they let them do it. So I fine Tom for letting a kid handle such a piece of equipment. Elaine Dishman was spotted in the newspaper. This was in the Tulsa World business section for Regent Bank. And of course, she's the face of the company. So thanks, Elaine. I fine her for that. That brought to mind my own fine. I'm finding myself, if anybody reads Tulsa People anymore, my law firm, Connor and Winters, turned 85, and my face somehow showed up on there. If anybody knows a good lawyer, I'm not getting any royalties out of this, so. But I'm paying $25 to show that off. I spotted Paula Wood on TV this week, and Paula's been paying a lot of fines, so it's only $20, but she was on Channel 2 discussing holiday decorations, and she did a great job, and thanks, Paula. Casey Tarp, a Rotarian with Beck Design. So he was featured in the Tulsa World. It's a really cool article. His company is actually in charge of the renovation of the Performing Arts Center. And they asked him 5 questions, so he paid $10 for each question he answered. And the last question I noticed was, if he preferred real trees or fake trees. And he took the very diplomatic answer and said both. It was, I thought that was very smart of him. Jesse Guardiola, I don't know if Jesse is here, but he was featured in the newspaper about police recruiting. So I find him $30. This one's kind of special to me, too. Jesse's the reason I'm in this club. He recruited me, and I work with him on the Hispanic Affairs Commission, specifically on issue of recruiting Hispanic officers. So I'm really proud of the work that Jesse does there. He's gotten me involved. I do what I can from with the resources I have. I also have been wanting to find Jesse for a long time to show off these pictures. I don't know if anybody remembers these from Tulsa Style magazine. Our Rotarian Lou Ann Buhlinger actually wrote the article. And I just wanted to always make fun of Jesse for looking very dapper in public. All right, Jerry Barrientos, 11 years in Rotary, $111. So she is paying this money to have me tell you a story, just like last time. So, you know, Jerry, she owns her own company, and sometimes she has to recruit lawyers. So she told me a story about a young lawyer she interviewed, and she asked him very straightforwardly, "How can I trust that you're an honest lawyer?" So the young attorney told her, "Well, my father loaned me $15,000 for my legal education. I promised to pay it back, and after my first trial, I paid him back in full." And Jerry said, "Okay, that's very impressive. Out of curiosity, what kind of case was it?" The young lawyer squirmed a little bit and said, "Well, my dad sued me for the money." Thanks, Jerry. Paul Bowman turned 45. He paid $45, sent me this picture. This was after an overtime win a couple of years ago with, I believe that's his brother, his son, and his nephew. So thanks, Paul, and go Kansas City. Jeff Smith, $100. He wants to wish everyone a family-filled Merry Christmas. It's a picture of him and his family, his wife, Gloria, son, Weston, son Jeff, and daughter-in-law Gabrielle. Thanks, Jeff. Stephen Robards, congratulations to his son Ethan. He's donating $500 in honor of his son. University of Tulsa graduation. He graduated recently, cum laude, computer science with a minor in math. This is a picture of him. And I guess on the right, it's a tradition of, I guess the University of Tulsa does. Sorry, I'm not an alum. Okay, the ringing of the Kindle bell is one of the oldest traditions at TU. Dates back more than half a century. It's tradition for graduating seniors to celebrate their entry into the Alumni Association by ringing the cupola bell after completing the last final exam of their TU career. So there's Ethan ringing the bell. Very impressive, and thanks to Stephen. That's a big deal. Another big one, Matt Bristow, $2,000 from him and his family, $1,000 for a water well to be in honor of the Hawkins, Winton, and Bristow families, and $1,000 to the Rotary Club. Of course, it was introduced at the beginning. Matt's father-in-law, Jim Hawkins, is here. Here's a picture Matt sent me of Jim and his wife Robin and 9 grandkids. Is that all of them? So thank you, Matt, thank you, Jim, and thank you to your families. It's very much appreciated. So that's all I have. Let's just pretend this is my house right here, but Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, Happy Holidays. I'll see you guys in several weeks.
Great, thanks you, Dan.
And thanks, of course, to Frosty. Bye.
Bye, Frosty. Our Rotarian of the day is John Croissant. John was raised in Tulsa and attended Jenks High School. He earned a bachelor's degree in political science and education from the University of Tulsa. He's been an educator for over 16 years. He's taught 6th grade pre-AP geography at Edison Middle School for the last 12 years. John, who's an advocate for public schools and for teachers, ran for the Oklahoma House of Representatives in 2016. He owns John Croissant Allstate Insurance Agency, volunteers at Edison once a week, coaches 2 recreational soccer teams, and serves as a volunteer for Life Kids, the Midtown Life Church on Sunday evenings. Please help me welcome John Croissant.
Thank you, Hannibal, and to the Rotary Club of Tulsa. It's a real privilege to be the Rotarian of the Day, and especially to have the opportunity to introduce our speaker today. James Frederick Jim Bridenstine serves as the 13th administrator of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. He has had a lifetime interest in space and aviation, and he now oversees our nation's space program and drives its plans to send humans back to the moon and to Mars. He has a vast portfolio of science, technology, and aeronautics initiatives that is increasing our nation's capabilities and shaping a bright future. He was nominated by President Trump, confirmed by the U.S. Senate, and sworn in as the nation's NASA's 13th administrator on April 23rd, 2018. Bridenstine was elected in 2012 to represent Oklahoma's 1st Congressional District in the United States House of Representatives, where he served on the Armed Services Committee and the Science, Space, and Technology Committee. Bridenstine's career in federal service began in the U.S. Navy, flying the E-2C Hawkeye off the USS Abraham Lincoln aircraft carrier. It was there that he flew combat missions in Iraq and Afghanistan and accrued most of his 1,900 flight hours and 333 carrier-assisted landings. He later moved to the F-18 Hornet and flew at the Naval Strike and Air Warfare Center, the parent command to Top Gun. And I bet you guys are wondering, what was his call sign? Right? Was it Maverick, Goose? No. It was, and this kind of says why he's our NASA administrator now, Brainstem. So, he's been a smart guy for a long time. After transitioning from active duty to the U.S. Navy Reserve, Bridenstine returned to Tulsa, Oklahoma, to be the executive director of the Tulsa Air and Space Museum and Planetarium. Bridenstine was promoted to the rank of lieutenant commander in 2012 while missions in Central and South America in support of America's war on drugs. Most recently, he transitioned to the 137th Special Operations Wing of the Oklahoma Air National Guard. Bridenstine completed a triple major at Rice University and earned his MBA at Cornell. He has 3 children with his wife, Michelle. He's a fellow Jinx Trojan and an Eagle Scout. And everyone, please welcome our esteemed guest, Jim Bridenstine.
Well, thank you for that really amazing introduction. And Hannibal, thank you for having me here at the Rotary Club of Tulsa. I will say, as you read that bio, a number of things were going through my head historically. And I was reminded 2 nights ago, my 6-year-old, who was born when I was running for Congress the first time, and he has heard me give speech after speech after speech about pretty much every topic under the sun, including probably at this group from time to time. And he asked me a question the other night. He said, he's 6 years old. He said, "Dad, if an aircraft carrier crashed into the moon, would we be able to plant trees so that they could breathe?" And it dawned on me that I've been doing a lot of different things, and he's like putting it all in his head at the same time. But thank you for that long intro. It's an honor to be back here. This is not my first time here. As the executive director of the Tulsa Air and Space Museum, I had the opportunity to speak to this very impressive group before when we were trying to get a retiring space shuttle for the Tulsa Air and Space Museum. I spoke to this group about that effort, and this group got very involved and was very helpful. When we were putting together an air show, the biggest air show Tulsa has ever had, we came to this group and presented that idea and, of course, had the support. And, of course, the Tulsa Air and Space Museum has had the support of this group going back long before, back when I was still flying in the United States Navy. This group supported, sponsored the library for the Tulsa Air and Space Museum. And Tanya Blanchett is here. She's the current executive director of the Tulsa Air and Space Museum. She's doing an absolutely amazing job. She's a professional educator. So what we do at NASA is we do stunning achievements to inspire generations, and of course Tanya is taking that here in Tulsa and putting it on steroids so that the next generation of kids can be inspired. But it's amazing to be back here to, I think the last time I spoke before this group, I was actually debating my opponents in a political campaign. So not all memories are fond, but but I will tell you, it is great to be back here. I'm so glad that it worked out that I was here at Christmas and we were able to have this really amazing opportunity. My wife has told me I will be done at 1 o'clock, and of course Hannibal told me I'm gonna be done at 12:55. So before we go any further, I want to show a video. This is a video about what NASA is up to right now, and then I'll speak to it here in just a few minutes.
Ignition sequence start. All engines are running.
We have taken tremendous steps.
We choose to go to the moon before this decade is out.
We have achieved the earth-shaking, the breathtaking, the groundbreaking.
One small step for man.
And left a mark in the heavens. Our successes build one upon another and amplify what is possible.
The dawn of Orion.
It's time we take the next great leap. We're building the next chapter of American exploration, returning to the moon to stay, so we can go beyond to Mars, to expand what's possible and further our understanding. The architecture for these missions is already taking shape. We will go with new systems, bold designs, and a sustainable mission. You can hear it, taste it, touch it. We are going. We are training, testing, pressing our pioneering spirit into every component, defining our resolve with every line of code, and securing our success with every welcomed partnership. This is not hypothetical. This is not about flags and footprints. This is about sustainable science and feeding forward the advance of the human spirit. Because we are the pioneers, the star sailors, the thinkers, the visionaries, the doers. And because we stand on the shoulders of giants to go farther than humanity has ever been, we will add our names to the rolls of the greatest adventurers in history. Every day, every mission, we advance this calling. We are NASA. And after 60 years, we're just getting started.
So as you heard in the video, this time when we go to the moon, we're going to stay. And in fact, that's the president's very first space policy directive. He says we're going to go to the moon, we're going to do it sustainably. The question is, what does that mean, sustainably? A couple of things. Not too long ago, NASA made a decision that when it comes to low Earth orbit, where there is a robust commercial marketplace, NASA is not going to be building, owning, and operating its own rockets. We're going to buy access to space as a service. We're going to have multiple competitors competing on cost and innovation, driving down the cost for our access to space, and NASA will be one customer of many customers, again, spreading the cost among, a lot of different customers. The idea being, where there is a robust commercial marketplace, we're going to take advantage of that robust commercial marketplace, and then we can use your dollars to do things where there isn't yet a robust commercial marketplace. In other words, go to the moon, and this time to stay. So how do we do that? Well, we have learned that when we compete on cost and innovation, and we are one customer of many, the cost goes down and access goes up to space. So we want to do that for the entire architecture, not just to low Earth orbit, but between the Earth and the moon. We have seen, for example, when we buy access to space as a service, people competing on cost and innovation, they are now reusing rockets. You in this room have probably seen rockets deploy payloads to space and then come back and land, reusing the rocket. Friends, that drops cost immensely. Imagine flying across the United States of America, and when you land, you have to throw your 737 into the garbage. How much would it cost to fly across the... How many of us would even fly? The cost would be so high. Well, that's how we've been accessing space for so long. And now we're to the point where we can reuse rockets. Well, we want to reuse not just access to low Earth orbit. We want the entire architecture from Earth to the moon to be reusable. So we need tugs that go from Earth orbit to lunar orbit to be reusable tugs. We need a reusable command module in orbit around the moon permanently. We call it the Gateway, and it's under development right now at NASA. And of course, we need landers that can go back and forth to the surface of the moon over and over and over again in a reusable way. We think back to Apollo. We think back to that Saturn rocket, which was in the video, that massive rocket. The only thing that came back to Earth out of that multi-billion dollar piece of gear was that little tiny capsule at the top that carried our three astronauts. And by the way, when it came back into the atmosphere, it was done. It could not be reused. That's why it was so expensive, and that is why it wasn't sustainable. This time, friends, we're going to build a sustainable architecture with reusability built into the system. And the president has said, in Space Policy Directive 1, that we're going to go with international partners and commercial partners. We think about what's happening on the International Space Station. Next year, for the first time since the retirements of the space shuttles in 2011, which, by the way, I was happy to champion us getting one of those. It didn't work out. But for the first time since 2011, next year, we will be launching American astronauts on American rockets from American soil. So we think about this sustainable, reusable architecture. That capability is going to be done commercially. We're buying access as a, we're buying access to space as a service, not purchasing, owning, and operating our own equipment when necessary. But it is true that when there is no commercial marketplace, we are going to be building, which that video you saw clearly, we are in fact building this sustainable, reusable architecture. We're going to retire risk. We're going to prove technology. We're going to prove capability. We're going to prove human physiology. How do we stay on the moon for long periods of time? And this is also important in the president's first space policy directive. We're going to utilize the resources of the moon. People say, well, what does that mean? We now know that there are hundreds of billions of tons of water ice on the surface of the moon. You go back to 1969 when we landed on the moon the first time, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin. 1969 to 1972, we landed on the surface of the moon six times with 12 humans, and we brought samples back. And from 1969 all the way up until 2008, we believed that the moon was bone dry. And then there was a time when India actually did an experiment, and they demonstrated that there's potentially water ice at the poles of the moon. Then NASA does an experiment. We now know that there's hundreds of billions of tons of water ice on the poles of the moon. What does that mean? Well, water ice represents not just water to drink, it's also oxygen. It's air to breathe. And hydrogen and oxygen, when water ice is cracked into its component parts, hydrogen and oxygen, put into cryogenic form, friends, that's rocket propulsion. That's the same propulsion that powered the space shuttles. It's the same propulsion that will power the Space Launch System, which we're building right now at NASA, the largest rocket ever to be built, taller than the Statue of Liberty, with 130 million tons of payload that it can throw into low Earth orbit. Hundreds of billions of tons of rocket fuel on the surface of the moon. That's transformative for what we can do in space. Here's the glory of the moon. It has no atmosphere. You've seen back in the Apollo era what we can take off the surface of the moon, what we can land on the moon. It doesn't look aerodynamic. It looks like a clunker. But we're able to fly it to the moon because there's no atmosphere. It doesn't need any aerodynamic fairings. And the other glory of the moon is that the gravity well is 1/6 that of Earth. It's really easy. It's not easy. But it's easier to get things onto and off the moon than onto and off of the Earth. So that gives us an advantage when it comes to utilizing the resources of the moon. The other big question is, and we don't know the answer, but we're familiar with what we call rare earth metals. Well, rare earth metals are not earth metals at all. They're asteroid impacts from billions of years ago. The challenge with the earth is that we have this active hydrosphere and we have an active geology. And something that hit the earth a billion years ago is not where it was a billion years ago. In fact, it's very hard to discover. And when you can find it, it's in very small amounts. Well, the moon does not have an active geology and it does not have an active hydrosphere. We now know because of NASA science that the water on the moon is being created every day in very small amounts, but it is being created. But it doesn't have an active hydrosphere. What does this mean? An asteroid impact, these precious metals that we call rare earth metals, which are actually asteroid impacts, they could be available on the surface of the moon to I don't know how many tons would be there, but it could be a lot. We don't know. The bottom line is, we don't know. But in my opinion, we should find out. And that's what we're working on. We're going to utilize the resources of the moon. You know, it could be that if there's hundreds of trillions of dollars worth of platinum group metals on the surface of the moon, that could change the balance of power on Earth, depending on who gets there first and what kind of architecture exists to get that metal back and forth. I'm not saying it exists. Nobody knows. But we didn't know until 2009 that there was water on the surface of the moon, and now we know, and we need to do something about it. So we're going to prove the technology with a reusable, sustainable architecture between the Earth and the Moon. We're going to go with international partners. Right now, I just got back from Europe. We're building an international coalition of nations that can create this sustainable architecture between the Earth and the Moon. And the reason we have it international is because all of us can do far more than any one of us can do alone. And we also have commercial capabilities that can help us as well. But we're going to retire the risk, prove the technology, prove the capability. Then we're going to take all of this capability, as much of it as possible, and we're going to replicate it at Mars. Now, Mars is a whole different challenge. See, the Earth and the Moon, we're a system. Wherever the Earth goes, the Moon goes with us. Well, the Earth and Mars, we're oftentimes not aligned on the same side of the sun, let alone a system. So when we get to Mars, which is about a 7-month journey, our astronauts are going to have to be there for about 2 years before they can come home, the next time the Earth and Mars are on the same side of the sun. That means we have to figure out how to utilize the resources of Mars. How do we utilize the water ice on the moon, prove the capability, prove the technology, and then we can use the water ice on Mars for human survival for up to 2 years. That's ultimately the goal. Here's the other fascinating thing. We now know that there's water ice throughout the entire solar system. Because of what NASA has done, we have an entire moon around Jupiter called Europa, and Europa is a water world. It's about the size of our moon, but it is all water. It's got an ice shell. This moon of Jupiter has an ice shell. What does that mean? Well, that means that whatever is inside that ice shell, within that liquid ocean, whatever is in there is protected from the harsh radiation environment of deep space, especially the harsh radiation environment around Jupiter. So, again, I'm not saying there's life, but there's a potential for life when you think about what's available there. Enceladus, which is a moon of Saturn, also another water world with an ice shell and a liquid ocean on the inside. Just since I've been the NASA administrator for the last 8 months, here are some things that we've discovered as an agency. Number one, there are complex organic compounds on the surface of Mars. That was a massive discovery. That doesn't guarantee there's life on Mars, but the building blocks for life are there, which we did not know until just a few months ago. We now know that Mars has methane cycles, and those methane cycles are perfectly commensurate with its seasons. That doesn't guarantee that there's life on Mars, but it increases the probability. And we now know that Mars has liquid water, not just ice at the poles, but it has liquid water 10 kilometers below its surface. Again, it doesn't guarantee there's life, but it increases the probability. Because of the missions that we have done to Mars, we know that Mars used to have a strong magnetosphere that protected it from the radiation environment. And because it had that strong magnetosphere, it also had a thick atmosphere. And the northern hemisphere of Mars was 2/3, maybe 3/4, covered with an ocean. These are all discoveries, not those most the most recent ones, but the fact that methane cycles are commensurate with the seasons, the fact that there's liquid water 10 kilometers below the surface of Mars, the fact that there's complex organic compounds on Mars, these are all discoveries that have happened just in the last 8 months since I've been the NASA administrator. That's why it's actually so phenomenal to have this job, because we're making new discoveries every day. So here's what we're doing. We're going to the moon. We're going with international partners and commercial partners. We're going to go sustainably. We're going to be able to go back and forth to the surface of the moon with landers and robots and rovers and humans. We're going to prove technology, prove capability. We're going to retire risk, replicate that at Mars. And ultimately, here's what we're doing. We are following the water because, in my view, the number one thing we ought to be trying to achieve at this point is finding life on a world that's not our own. And I don't know if it's there, but neither does anybody else. But we didn't know that water ice existed out there until just really within the last decade. So what an amazing opportunity to be at the helm of this impressive agency. I've got about 5 minutes before I get the hook, but I wanted to see if we could open it up to a few questions from the audience, and then we'll close it out. Does somebody have a microphone, or do I just call on somebody? Oh, he's got a microphone coming. Okay.
Just curious, you know, 4, 8, 12, 16 years from now when administrations change, what are you doing? You know, these ideas that you have are wonderful, but to make sure that they actually continue, you know, beyond your time there and the next person comes in and isn't just going to kind of take it all away.
So that has happened in the past. And the goal here is to make it sustainable. That's the key word in the president's first space policy directive, because what happens is the agency goes a direction, new administration comes in, it goes another direction, new administration goes another direction. What we're doing here is we're building into the architecture international partnerships and commercial partnerships, which previously, when we've done this activity, President George Herbert Walker Bush had the Space Exploration Initiative to go to the moon. That ultimately got canceled. President George W. Bush had the vision for space exploration, which was, again, to go to the moon. Back then, we didn't have commercial partners, which means we didn't have the ability to drop the cost the way we do today. We didn't have the miniaturization of electronics in the way that we have today. And those programs ultimately didn't have the international partnerships that exist today. There's now more space agencies on the face of the planet than ever before. And we're going to take advantage of all that to make sure that this time when we go, it is, in fact, sustainable. And so that's a great question, but it's something that's high on my agenda to make sure that it is sustainable for the long term.
Thank you for being here. I have a question on how you prioritize who has claims and rights to the assets on the Earth's moon. Are there other countries that would say just because we got there first, they have rights as well? Or I'll let you speak to that.
No, it's a wonderful question. So a couple of things. The Outer Space Treaty of 1967 actually addressed this, which back then nobody knew that we would have this like economic opportunity to go to the surface of the moon. So here's what we know. You cannot expropriate the surface of the moon for any one nation. Nobody can own the moon. But the Outer Space Treaty is clear that we can use the resources of the moon. And what that means is that when a nation goes to the moon or a private company, remember, the architecture that we're building is open. The way we do data, the way we do communications, the way we do docking, the way we do avionics, it's all going to be available on the internet. So each piece of this architecture, whether it's the launchers, the tugs, the command module in orbit around the moon, the landers, anybody who wants to build something that can work into this architecture, whether you're a private company, maybe a rich individual, or a small country, you're going to be able to plug into this architecture. But here's the thing. The resources that are extracted from the moon are owned based on the investment that you've made and the sweat that you've put into that effort. So you can, according to the Outer Space Treaty, utilize the resources of the moon, which means the resources are available for private ownership, but the moon itself is not. So we would have to operate much the same way as we operate in international waters. So as a Navy pilot, we operate what's called due regard over international waters. And that, I think that is the model that ultimately we're going to have to set when we go to the moon. It's also important that this time when we go, we need to get there fast, and we need to go with commercial partners and international partners that understand what private property rights are and why they're important, because ultimately development requires private property rights. So your point is very well taken. It's something we're thinking about and considering. I'm going to do one more question, then we'll close it out.
Please describe for us the type of vehicle, what it's going to be like that's going to move human beings from Earth's surface in the, here in the United States to orbit around the moon for the rest of these things you've been talking about.
So we're talking about what we call the Space Launch System. It's the biggest rocket ever built. A lot of the components on it, it's got... The main engines are very similar to the space shuttle main engines, and the boosters are going to be solid rocket boosters, very similar to the solid, in fact, they are the solid rocket boosters from the space shuttle, just a little bit larger. And then this vehicle will take our astronauts on a capsule called Orion all the way up to this permanent command module in orbit around the moon, where our astronauts are going to be able to either telerobotically work with robots on the surface of the moon. In other words, telerobotically meaning, you know, from Earth to the moon, there's a delay in the signal. But when you get into orbit around the moon, that delay isn't there. And so what we're trying to achieve ultimately is to have more presence on the moon than ever before. We don't want to miss another opportunity. Again, we missed the water ice for almost 40 years. We don't want to miss anything else. We need more access to more parts of the moon than ever before. That reusable command module we call Gateway, think of it as a spaceship. It's going to have solar electric propulsion. It's going to be able to go to the North Pole of the moon and the South Pole of the moon and deploy landers to get to more parts of the moon than we've ever been able to get to before. And our astronauts are ultimately going to be able to live and work there for a period of up to 2 months. It's not going to be like the International Space Station because it's not protected the way the International Space Station is by the magnetosphere of Earth, and what you might be familiar with the Van Allen radiation belts, that kind of thing. But they're going to be able to stay there for up to 2 months. I want to say this in closing. This is an important point that I'm going to close out. A lot of people say to me, why are we investing in this? We're talking about 0.5% of the federal budget. That's what NASA's budget is. 0.5% of the federal budget. People say, why do we invest in that when we've got all these other challenges going on? Here's the thing. The way we communicate as individuals, whether you have DirecTV, I see all the media here. Some people are going to watch this maybe on DirecTV, Dish Network. Maybe you get internet broadband from space. Of course, as a Navy pilot, we used space-based communications for national security reasons. But the way we communicate is dependent on space. The way we navigate with GPS, dependent on space. The way we produce food, we're now feeding more of the world than ever before because of NASA technology in space, helping farmers know when to plant, when to yield, ultimately what kind of fertilizer to use, and when to water. So we're feeding more of the world because of NASA technology. The way we produce energy in this country, the way we do disaster relief and national security in this country, all dependent on space. Ultimately, the way we predict weather, which many in this room are familiar that I was very involved in that as a member of Congress, and the way we understand our changing climate. And friends, it is changing. The question is, you know, how much are we contributing to it? That's what NASA's job is. We're going to continue to study it and learn and share that data publicly with the world. Policymakers can make decisions. We don't do that, but we're going to continue to study it. This is also important to note. The way we do banking, I know there's a lot of bankers in this room. Every banking transaction requires a timing signal from GPS. The way we regulate flows of electricity, so when I say that, I'm talking about your ATM, for example. I'm talking about your credit card when you go to the fill your car up with gas. The way we do regulation of flows of electricity on the power grid requires a timing signal from GPS. The way we regulate flows of data on terrestrial wireless networks, again, requires a timing signal from GPS. Our society, we do not recognize it, but I'm hoping, based on my words here today, you recognize it today. We are dependent as a nation and as a society on space in ways that we never could have imagined even 20 or 30 years ago. And I think that what's important to note is that this dependency is not a bad thing. We have elevated the human condition, not just for Americans, but for everybody in the world in ways that 20 or 30 years ago we couldn't have even imagined. And we've done this for 0.5% of the federal budget. Not every program I just mentioned is a NASA program, but NASA blazed the trail for all of these things, and I haven't even mentioned the spinoffs. Many people in the room, I've heard people tell me about Tang or tell me about Velcro, those kind of things. That's what people are familiar with. But our civilization as a whole is not just dependent on space, but it has been elevated because of space. It is now a critical piece of who we are as society, which is one of the reasons you hear the president talk a lot about the Space Force, because as we have become more and more dependent on it, it has become more and more threatened. And some of the competitors of the United States have called space the American Achilles heel. If they can destroy space, they can destroy our very way of life. You would go to the bank and your ATM card wouldn't work. In fact, no banking transaction would work. In fact, there'd be no milk in the grocery store in a matter of days. That's how important space is to our everyday lives. And I'm hoping, if I can do nothing else as the NASA administrator, is get that point across that we, as a society, need to protect space and use it to its full advantage for science, discovery, and exploration. Thank you so much for having me here today.
So thank you, Mr. Bridenstine, for a great presentation. A book recognizing today's program will be presented to our partner at Education School, Celia Clinton. And this week's book is, appropriately, Curiosity, the Story of a Mars Rover.
There we go.
And it's been signed by Mr. Bridenstine.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. So let's not lose sight of that grand Rotary International vision. Together we see a world where people unite, take action to create lasting change across the globe, in our communities, and in ourselves. Happy holidays, happy new year to everyone. Our next meeting will be January the 9th. Please note that our new members and their sponsors will be at the guest table area in the foyer as you exit. Please take a moment to personally welcome Eric and Mark to our Rotary family. And with that, we are adjourned.